Upper Suwanee Springs. These are both on the Upper Suwanee. It's the same methods were used. And what, again, you see is if the Gulf Surge and Suwanee Passage involved, that's the limiting factor here. The percentage allowable is a little different because it's become, as you get kind of more of a base flow influence to the river, you see this percentage start to go down some. So as you get to Suwanee Springs, that 96.8 CFS equates to about 11% change in the median. And then going down to the first middle Suwanee gauge, this is at Ellaville. You'll see the metrics are a little different here, and this is just based on how our consultants, you know, thought the best approach would be. In some cases, I didn't mention this earlier, but there may be specific analyses they were able to do that, you know, were appropriate to the middle Suwanee but not the upper Suwanee. For example, they thought it was important to look at whether fish could pass in and out of two of these spring runs here that were in this Ellaville stretch. And then they also looked at a few different wetland habitat types and geomorphic metrics. But guess what? Ultimately, it came down again to Gulf Surge and Spawning Passage in the fall as being the limiting factor here. At a 346 CFS allowable, which would be a 9.1% reduction in the median. And then finally, for Branford, that's the furthest downstream gauge. Really, same story on Gulf Sturgeon Passage in the fall. But again, see, this 400 CFS is it's a lower percent by the time you get to this point in the river at 8%. And so, to summarize all that, these would be the actual MFLs, you know, the minimum flows that would need to be met at each of the four river gauges with their corresponding percent at the median there. And I guess let's read these off. So that would be 594 CFS at White Springs, 783 CFS at Suwanee Springs, 3,476 CFS at Ellaville, and 4,593 CFS at Branford. And then the last thing I'll mention here, before we open this up for some questions, the springs, I mentioned we're still working on those. Really what we've seen is these springs along the Suwanee River in particular are pretty different from like a typical riverine system. And for some spring systems that we've worked on here, like the Ishitechni, you know, it is kind of a river unto itself. And we can apply a lot of these same types of river analyses that we would apply for the Suwanee or the San Fe. But these springs along the Suwanee are pretty different. And they're also much more affected by the river itself in terms of when it floods. It can really affect either the flows and the water quality and the ecology of these springs. And so that's something we're looking at pretty closely now, is the, you know, the effect of those flood events themselves. We're also looking at other water quality aspects. We're looking at how flows in these springs could affect the amount of algae that accumulates. We're not just looking at ecology either. I mean, a lot of the value of these springs is that they're good places to go swim and cool off in the summer months. So we're going to be looking at that. Also going to look at the morphology and what flows are needed to kind of maintain those springs as they are. And then also how those springs may affect downstream ecosystems. Because they're putting out water that's generally pretty different than the river water itself in terms of the chemistry and the temperatures and things like that. So that's something else we're actively investigating, and our intent is later this year to move forward with proposed MFLs for at least those four outstanding Florida springs that I was showing earlier. Hopefully that time we'll have some, you know, some leads on some really good approaches that we can apply more broadly